So I think that actually there's much more asymmetry in evolution than perhaps we tend to think. We always think about floral evolution as coevolution of a flower and an insect. But as far as I can see, all the evidence suggests that it's much more complicated than that. And very often, one species of insect is involved with lots of species of flowering plants. What is totally unclear is the details of environments historically. So if you go back to the earlier Cretaceous, what was the environment there? What a number of people have suggested, for instance, working on wood anatomy, is that they simply don't understand what was going on in the, say, middle of the Cretaceous, early Cretaceous, based on what they know about. So the current thought is that early insects are in fact fairly specialized in terms of who they visit in plants, and yet morphologically they're fairly generalized, mm-hmm. right? And the plants they're visiting, paradoxically, are also generalized. So there's this paradox between specialization and generalization that makes it difficult to think about it clearly. So when you get to sort of asterids, you know, which is the bulk of the angiosperms, there many of them are visited by fairly generalist insects, which are nevertheless specialized. And these generalist but specialized insects are visiting specialized flowers. And so the paradox is keeping what generalized really means in your head and what specialized really means in your head. And so these quote-unquote generalized advanced insects nevertheless are very derived insects with very well-developed sensory capacity and stuff like this. So it's that allows them to visit many flowers, okay? and their morphology too. So they're specialized, but they're generalized at the same time. So that's everything, this is always the trouble I have of keeping this in my mm-hmm. head. And they're visiting also highly specialized plants. And then the original insects were probably more generalized in terms of their sensory capabilities, mm-hmm. but they're visiting a few species of plants. So there's this angiosperm phylogeny group classification, right? You know about that? Mm-hmm. Right. So that's when I first started thinking about that. And actually, I first started thinking about it just before I left Cambridge, Massachusetts. And then when I got to Missouri, there was a student who was, you know, who knew something about computers then, and together we put it together. So it was designed to educate, to try and synthesize all the work being done. And over the years, you know, one has simply been sort of trying to correct mistakes one made earlier and then integrate as much of the literature as one possibly can. And I've been thinking much more about adaptation and evolution over the last few years. Well, I sometimes think about the work I do as a semi-popularization, right? It's designed for students. I mean, also researchers, but it's designed, I was thinking of it initially, for students being able to synthesize the information in one place so they could get at it. And so one can't do everything in one place, right? And so, you know, someone should, someone always has to take higher level of information, try and digest it, make it more freely available. And so that I was just thinking about one step in that whole process. It's not easy, because you're always having to think about each word you use, right? I mean, do I have to define, this is a rhetorical question to you, but I mean, do I have to define it every time I use it? I mean, this is always what I'm thinking about. That's why I built a glossary at the end. Right. So that I didn't have to define everything. But even so, when I'm working on the evolution section, I'm always thinking, who's going to read this? What are they going to understand? And it's a challenge. I think the art of popularization is actually one of the most difficult things, really. It's much more difficult than being a scientist.